أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. فسبحان الله حين تمسون وحين تصبحون، وله الحمد في السماوات والأرض وعشيا وحين تظهرون. يخرج الحي من الميت ويخرج الميت من الحي ويحيي الأرض بعد موتها، وكذلك تخرجون. ومن آياته أن خلقكم من تراب ثم إذا أنتم بشر ومن آياته أن خلق لكم من أنفسكم أزواجا لتسكنوا إليها وجعل بينكم مودة ورحمة، إن في ذلك لآيات لقوم يتفكرون. ومن آياته خلق السماوات والأرض واختلاف ألسنتكم وألوانكم، إن في ذلك لآيات للعالمين. ومن آياته منامكم بالليل والنهار وابتغاؤكم من فضله، إن في ذلك لآيات لقوم يعقلون. صدق الله العظيم.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Brothers and sisters in Islam, ulay alhamd, we have our Sheikh, mashallah, Sheikh Yahya, here to deliver a reminder, a very timely reminder, pertaining to the blessing and the mercy of the month of Ramadan, which is approaching us very rapidly. Alhamdulillah, Muslim Aid has facilitated and sponsored this event for our masjid, our center, Edmonton. Alhamdulillah. It's from the virtue and mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that time after time that we're honored with our mashayikh. Sheikh Yahya, mashallah, he's come all the way from Canada to benefit us, and many of us were here at the khutbah today. And we can really see the concern and the power in the reminder from our Sheikh. May Allah preserve him and long his life and his family and take care of them. It's a very short announcement from the brothers from Muslim Aid. I actually don't work for them. Alhamdulillah, I'm one of your own here. I'm one of the brothers from the community, but mashallah, the brothers were not able to make it. So we took it upon ourselves to raise some funds for our brothers and sisters across the globe. It's one project that they'll be working on today, which is feeding the family in the month of Ramadan for £60. We have some buckets and some forms at the back. If brothers want to partake in this beautiful act. And remember, the month of Sha'ban is a training for us. So perhaps we can start from today, bi'idhnillah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We'll pass the mic to our beloved Sheikh Yahya. Barakallahu feekum once again, brothers and sisters, for coming. And please make dua for our mashayikh. Jazakumullahu khairan. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبد الله ورسوله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا اللهم صل وسلم وزد وبارك على سيدنا ونبينا محمد في الأولين وصلي وسلم وبارك على سيدنا محمد في الآخرين اللهم صلي وسلم وزد وبارك على سيدنا محمد في الملأ الأعلى يا أرحم الراحمين. We always begin with the praise of Allah. We send our prayers of peace upon our Nabi Muhammad صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. It's always a pleasure, alhamdulillah, to gather together in the house of Allah عز وجل وأن المساجد لله. And the abode of mercy that we seek with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the house of worship that we're gathered in today is a special aim that a believer always has, that we always seek to improve our relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that we come back to a path that is pleasing to Allah and enriching to our existence. And today, alhamdulillah, for the next 30-40 minutes, bi'idhnillahi ta'ala, I wish to speak about preparing ourselves for the month of Ramadan, using the month of Ramadan as a stepping stone to greatness, to changes in our life that we know we need to make. And I pray that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allows us to facilitate that. Hatta al-kalam yakoon, just so that our discussion is built on a methodology. I wish first to speak about who you are and what you need. And knowing who you are allows you to know what you need. And we need to speak a little bit about the Islamic philosophical perspective of what you are as an insan, as a human being, right? Who are you? And why has Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala written upon you as-siyam? كَمَا كُتِبَ عَلَى الَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِكُمْ As it was always written upon the nations who came before us. Therefore, there's a special purpose for abstinence, for holding back from things that are permissible. This bottle of water, there's no harm in it. And yet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, for many of you, jazakumullah khair in the month of Ramadan here, it's not like back home, I live in Australia at the moment. MashaAllah, I'm scared to tell you, might do a little bit of hasad on us. We break our fast at 5:15 in the afternoon, mashallah. I call it afternoon for you people, right? You keep going till 9, 9:30, subhanallah, rabbi al-a'la. No harm comes from this water. And yet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells you, leave it. Don't partake in it. Food that is halal, that you've earned from halal, that you purchased with halal, that you prepared in a halal way, don't touch it. Whether people see you or not makes no difference. And therefore there has to be higher aims. So who are we? And why is fasting something written upon us as it was written upon those who came before us? Let's answer that first question inshaAllah. Man anta? What are you? There are two words that Allah uses in the Quran to describe a human being. First, bashar, meaning hairless animal. SubhanAllah. It's a very important statement from a scientific perspective. I know there's, I'm sure, students of science here, those who have studied things like evolution and biology. All of a sudden, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala calls you and I, the species of Bani Adam, the hairless one. That's your name, bashar. You have a bashara. Meaning that there were other creations of Allah who were not what? Hairless. There were other things that had a cognitive understanding, who had obligations to Allah, creations before us, who had a responsibility to Allah, but there's one unique species that came, Adam alayhi salam, wa anta min dhurriyatihi, and you're from his offspring and his progeny. The second name is Insan, the forgetful one. وَلَقَدْ عَهِدْنَا إِلَىٰ آدَمَ. We gave a covenant to Adam, مِنْ قَبْلِ, from long ago, before he came to this earth. فَنَسِيَ وَلَمْ نَجِدْ لَهُ عَزْمًا. But we found that Adam was forgetful and had no constancy in his remembrance and his deliverance of what was ordered. And therefore you and I were created with a particular defect. Our natural default is the fitrah, is a natural inclination of doing what is good, doing what is right, but there's a defect that we forget. So Allah sends to you and I a dhikr al-hakim, an ever important wise reminder. And therefore the Quran, one of its names is dhikr. وَإِنَّهُ لَذِكْرٌ. It is a reminder. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants you to remember. The word dhikr in the context of the Quran means one of five things. The word dhikr means one of five things. Something you know but forgot. Something you don't know, muhdath. Something you don't know and Allah's going to introduce it. Something you know but didn't forget but want to forget. Pretend it's not in your life. Pretend you don't see it. Like I don't know. A dhikr is something that is a reminder to you so that you can remind others. فَذَكِّرْ إِنَّ الذِّكْرَ تَنْفَعُ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ. Remember Ya Muhammad so that you remind them as well. So when they see you pray, they pray. When they see you make your dhikr and your tasbih, they will make their dhikr. So the Prophet ﷺ said, إِنِّي أَتُوبُ إِلَى اللَّهِ وَأَسْتَغْفِرَهُ فِي الْيَوْمِ أَكْثَرُ مِنْ سَبْعِينَ مَرْ. Why does he tell you how much istighfar does he make, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? To remind you. He's not showing off, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Could you imagine if I come to you and I say, Salaamu alaykum ya akhi, today I did 100 istighfar. You say, akhi, baynaka wa bayna Allah, why are you telling me? La Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, litubayyinahu linnas. Show it to people, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Wala haraj. People need to see this example. Finally, number five, the word dhikr. It has the context of you remembering that there is a day you will be questioned that inside your heart you try to forget. So you live your life in a way where you have tool al-amal. Oh, I have a long life. I have many days. I have many moments. Inshallah, I will make tawbah. I'll go to hajj. And you forget that at any moment, at any time, you can be returned to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala without warning. Dhikr. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created you as an insan who forgets. So he's given you the capacity to remember. And from the orders of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is to recite upon us the Quran, to remind to us, وَيُعَلِّمُكُمُ الْكِتَابَ وَالْحِكْمَةَ وَيُزَكِّيكُمْ. Purify you. Meaning take away the things that you're doing wrong by showing you what to do right in its place. And the concept of dhikr is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala introduces for us the right things to do before He strips us away of the wrong things we need to stay away from for our own benefit. So whenever you hear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speak in the Qur'an, He says, وَأْمُرْ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ. Then He says, وَانْهَ عَنِ الْمُنْكَرِ. Instruct them in what is good, and then remind them about what is evil, forbidden upon them. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So you are an insan, one who is prone to forgetting their relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah created you and made your taqween from three things. There are three parts in me. As I sit in front of you now, I'm three different components that are together. This is from an Islamic philosophical perspective. The first thing I am is this. 70% of me is what? وَجَعَلْنَا مِنَ الْمَاءِ كُلَّ شَيْءٍ حَيٍّ. I destined, Allah said, I created everything that is hay, given life from this water. In front of you, you in front of me, most of you is H2O. Allahu Akbar. مِنْهَا خَلَقْنَاكُمْ. From the earth you were created. وَمِنْهَا نُعِيدُكُمْ And to the earth you will be buried. وَمِنْهَا نُخْرِجُكُمْ تَارَةً أُخْرَى See, the wood of this tree and me and you are very similar. You're an organic species. Did you know, Ya Abdullah, when someone had a defective heart, there was a problem with their heart. A valve that instead of keeping the blood out, it would seep blood. You're going to die. They said, hey, we need to fix this. Let's find an animal like this human, because you can't open a human being. You can't take another human being's heart, put it in you, and keep them alive. Let's take a valve from a species similar to a human being. So they went to the pig. Subhanallah. You know, a pig's heart, if you were to see it, you can't tell the difference between it and a human heart. Unless you run tests. From looking at it, no difference. The valves are the same. The genetic makeup is almost identical. 99.9% identical to you and I. So they would take that, put it in a... stitch it into the proper valve of another human being, and people would live for many, many years, decades, with a little concoction of drugs to make your body not reject it. It recognizes its genetic similarity. As a physical being, you're from this water. You're from the same genetic sources that everything else that walks the earth, very similar to you. Apes, primates, very similar to you. So what makes you different? Well, you're not just physical. You are a badan, but you're more than a badan. You're more than just a physicality. You're more than this. So there's another component. The second component is you have a aql. You've been given rationale, discernment, understanding. You're able to decide right from wrong, good from bad. You have emotions and expressions and language. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, يَا أَيُّهَا النَّاسِ إِنَّا خَلَقْنَاكُمْ مِنْ ذَكَرٍ وَأُنْثَى وَجَعَلْنَاكُمْ شُعُوبًا وَقَبَائِلَ لِتَعَارَفُوا That you talk with one another, recognize one another. And one of the creation of Allah that is given to us is that we have a communicative capacity. عَلَّمَ الْإِنسَانَ مَا لَمْ يَعْلَمْ Allah taught. اقرأ is the first word. بسم ربك الذي خلق خلق الإنسان من علق اقرأ وربك الأكرم الذي علم بالقلم When the angels ask Allah سؤال استفهام لا اعتراض Not asking in rejection but in understanding أتجعل فيها من يفسد فيها ويسفك الدماء ونحن نسبح بحمدك ونقدس لك Oh Allah will you put upon the earth One who will shed blood and cause corruption because they've seen it in the previous creations of Allah. In the other species that are like us, that weren't Bashar, but there were other creations who had levels of knowledge, levels of intellect. What makes Adam different? So Allah says, وَعَلَّمَ آدَمَ الْأَسْمَاءَ كُلَّهَا Allah gave Adam knowledge. ثم عرضهم على الملائكة قال أنبئوني بأسماء هؤلاء Show me the knowledge you have قالوا لا علم لنا إلا ما علمتنا قلنا يا آدم أنبئهم بأسماء Tell them يا آدم about the names of all things knowledge You and I we have the capacity to learn More importantly not just to learn and keep within but to learn and to teach It's unique But other species are able to train and learn. Monkeys are being taught at the moment to read and write. Monkeys have a greater cognitive capacity to you and I. If I was to give you a 10-digit number, and I ask you to remember it, and I come back a little while later, you forget it. If I give you 10 digits, 10 digits, 10 digits, forget it. If I give you the order, you forget it. Apes are able to keep it. Dolphins are able to keep it. So where do we go from physical, intellectual, The third is we've been given something other things have not, which is called a ruh, a nafs. You've been given a soul that makes you different to the animals, makes you accountable to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that He created Bani Adam fi ahsani taqwim, in the best and most complete of His creation, subhanahu wa ta'ala. And therefore you and I as an individual, we've been created with these three components. Any time one of them is not addressed, your life is out of balance and you're unhappy. إِنَّ الْإِنسَانَ لَيَطْرَى. Mankind is prone to excess. أَرْرَآهُ اسْتَغْنَى. They believe themselves self-sufficient. I don't need anyone. إِنَّ إِلَىٰ رَبِّكَ الرُّجْعَى. Does that person not know that to Allah will be their return? You have this capacity to go too far. Too far physically. Too far mentally. And sadly, too far in extreme spiritually. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala therefore sends for us something to center us. Something to bring you back to as-sirat al-mustaqim, a straight level path. To a path that is neither ifrat or tafriq. It's neither excessive nor negligent. That you don't go too much or too little. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala brings you back to the center. And one of the greater aims of the month of Ramadan in your surrender to Allah and your submission to Allah as a part of your tawheed is that you say, "Oh Allah, what you ask me to do, I will do, even if at times I do not understand its complete wisdom and aim." You begin later to understand some reasons. And we don't fast because it's good for our health, but it is good for your health. Those who fast, except that consecutive days, one and after another, are less likely to have free radicals within their system, cancerous cells within their system. It purges, especially within your gut. You're less likely to contain a lot of bad bacteria in your stomach, which is now being seen as one of the most powerful reasons for a lot of the cancers and ailments that troubles human beings. Little bacteria within you. There's many reasons that can be deduced from the wisdom of fasting. But I want you to think of the higher aims. As a human being, physically, Siyam comes to recalibrate, readjust your processes, your physical being. Intellectually, if you're fasting correctly, which we will talk about that shortly, inshallah, it begins to allow your mind to be clear about what your real goals and aims in life should be, what your plans should be, how you should think of your place in the world and your place with other people. And third and finally, it comes, as Allah says, كُتِبَ عَلَيْكُمُ الصِّيَامُ كَمَا كُتِبَ عَلَى الَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِكُمْ لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ. That you may grow in a sense of consciousness. وَالتَّقْوَى هَهُنَا. Taqwa is in within here, within your heart, meaning within your spirit, within your soul. It's a part of who you are. It's an expression of your faith in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I want to clarify something for you, inshallah. There's a difference between siyam and salm. You say, "Brother Yahya, but they come from the same root." Yes. Salm is voluntary. Siyam is mandatory. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about fasting the month of Ramadan, He uses the word siyam. Kutiba alaykumu siyam. Fasting is mandatory. Siyam in our Sharia is that there's no food or water when the sun is up or conjugal relations with your spouse. Khalas? That's siyam. Sawm is an addition to siyam. The Prophet ﷺ described sawm as being now an extra process, a thought that you do, not just the hunger and thirst of the body, not just physical, but it's an intellectual pursuit. مَنْ لَمْ يَدَعْ قَوْلَ الزُّورِ وَالْعَمَلَ بِهِ The one who is unable, unwilling, incapable of leaving off vanity of speech, sinful words, sinful discussions, gossip, backbite, lying, slander. The one who doesn't leave off those words, فَلَيْسَ لِلَّهِ حَاجَةً أَنْ يَدَعَ طَعَامَهُ وَشَرَابَهُ. Allah is in no need of them to leave their food and their drink. Because now it's not just siyam, it's not just food and drink, it's now sawm. Maryam alayhi salam, Allah orders her that when she is carrying her child, as she's walking, Bani Israel is going to accuse you of having committed sinfulness to produce this child. فَإِمَّا تَرَيَنَّ مِنَ الْبَشَرِ أَحَدًا فَقُولِ إِنِّي نَذَرْتُ لِلرَّحْمَانِ صَوْمًا, which is silence. فَلَنْ أُكَلِّمَ الْيَوْمَ إِنْسِيًّا. The conceptualization of sawm is that you're going past the normal siyam. It's an active process where you make decisions of what you say, what you hear, what you see, what you spend, who you're with. It becomes a process where you voluntarily go beyond hunger and thirst. Allahumma ja'alna minhum. May Allah make us of those who have sawm to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and not just fulfill the obligation of siyam. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he warns us not just about siyam but even about salah. In the authentic hadith, for example, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, Rubba rajul, perhaps a man, an individual, qama liyusalli, will stand up and pray to Allah, وَلَمْ يُكْتَبْ لَهُ, and nothing will be written in reward for that individual, إِلَّا نِصْفُهَا أَوْ رُبْعُهَا أَوْ عُشْرُهَا. They will only get half of the reward of their prayer, a quarter of the reward of their prayer, maybe for some, a tenth, عُشْ. They stood up to Allah and got 1 out of 10 in reward. And there are some who will fast the month of Ramadan and they don't get the reward of Siyam because they have not permitted themselves to enter into sawm. So their punishment is not that they didn't fast to Allah. Their punishment is that they're not giving the completeness of its reward. Allahumma la taj'alna minhum. May Allah protect us from being of them. I want you to start beginning to think about the month of Ramadan as bringing harmony to the three parts of who you are: physically, intellectually, and spiritually. Reboot, restart, going back to a purity of beginning. One of the most beautiful statements of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and I want you to think about why the reward of siyam is this particular reward that your sins are forgiven. Why is it that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala informs our Prophet As-sawmu li wa ana ajzi bih. Fasting is only for Allah, and only Allah will give its reward. Every good deed you do, it's multiplied minimum by 10 times. You recite alif lam mim 30 hasanat. Alif harf, lam harf, mim harf, wal hasanatu bi ashri amthaliha. Illa sawm, Allah says, except fasting. Fa innahu li, it's only for me. Wa ana ajzi bih, I'm the one who gives its reward. Greatly or a smaller amount. The basis of siyam is what psychologists today would call deferred gratification, sabr. It's to teach you to be patient, subhanAllah. It's to hold on when others crumble. It's to go further than others would. It's to learn that in life, not everything should come the moment you want it. And that you can look at your watch and there's half an hour left for siyam and you're hungry. And nobody's there, but I'm not going to break my trust with Allah. I can be sitting in my office on a hot day. Nobody in the world will see that I took a sip of water. Nobody. But it's between me and Allah. وَأَصَّوْمُ لِي وَأَنَا أَجْزِي بِهِ. Nobody knows what is the reward that I will have with Allah. Because it's with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. صَوْمُ إِنَّمَا يُوَفَّى الصَّابِرُونَ أجرهم بغير حساب. What makes us understand that sabr and siyam are attached to each other is that Allah uses the same reward for both acts as being equal to each other. That the one who has patience, they will be given a reward that is unlimited. While the one who fasts to Allah and performs sawm with their siyam, their reward is unlimited with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Why did I use that word delayed gratification? In the 50s, psychologists had an experiment. It's called the marshmallow test. They would bring in young children, 3-4 years old, bring them into a room, sit them at a table. A camera in the corner that the child doesn't know is recording. As they're sitting at the table, they would put a marshmallow. That was the treat back then. They put a marshmallow in front of them. And they would say to this 4-year-old boy and girl, "This marshmallow is yours, but you can eat it. But if you wait until I go to my office and come back, I'll give you another one. You'll get 2 marshmallows. Just wait 3 minutes. I'm going to go to my room and I'll come back. If you can wait, don't touch this, don't eat this. If I come back, this marshmallow is still here, I'll give you a second one. You've doubled what you have." They found that there were a number of types of children. One child, before the man even left, they ate it. MashaAllah, barakallah. He's like, yeah, okay, mashaAllah. Impulsive. Could not wait. Had no sabr. There was another child who was deceptive. They pick it up, lick it. Smell it. Take a little bit of the powder. Eat the base of it. Eat half of it, put it back. Take another piece, put it back. They come back and they, "What happened?" "Oh, I don't know." "So who did it?" "I didn't see." "You sure you didn't touch it?" The third, and they're less than 15%. Less than 15% were those who saw the marshmallow and waited. "Can get 2, mashallah, double." Some, when the men came back, they said, "If I wait more, will you give me another one?" "I'll wait here all day. I have that strength." By the way, you're not born with that. You're taught that. It's something your parents teach you. May Allah assist us to prepare our children for life. Some of us, we weren't taught that. Some of us, you want something, so you cry, your mother gives it. You throw something, so here. The child begins to cry, "Take my phone." You're hungry, eat. Everything is provided before request. There's no sabr, no deliberation. Some of it is because when we were younger, we didn't have what we wanted. So now that we have children, I'm going to give them what they want. SubhanAllah, I used to ask and I couldn't have. Now I can give, why shouldn't I? And we create a monster. إِنَّمَا يُوَفَّ الصَّابِرُونَ أَجْرَهُمْ بِغَيْرَ حِسَابٍ. Have you ever walked into a brother or sister's house and for their children they built a Toys R Us? They have every toy, mashallah, in the shop. And none of the toys are being played with and they keep adding more and more and more. You go home and you see one of the children, he's got a PlayStation. How many games do you have? 40. 20. 15. 15 games. How many do you play? "Oh, I play 1 or 2. Because we've been taught, "Al-hakum al-takathur." You want more. So Allah tells you, la. Ta'ala. Usbiru wa sabiru wa rabitu. There's patience. You go to a sister's house, how many scarves does she have? She's got a pink scarf, a light pink scarf, a dark pink scarf, a pink scarf with gray, with orange, with yellow. MashaAllah. I remember my wife, Allah yahdina wa yahdiha, habibah Allah. She says, "Yahya, can you get me a gray and pink scarf?" I said, "You have one." She goes, "No, this is pink and gray." I said, "Allahu Akbar. Gray and pink or pink and gray? It's the same thing. Allah, Allah, this is life." The first group of children, impulsive. You know what they did with these children? They followed them for 40 years. Those same children, from 1952, they followed them into the senior years until they began to pass away. The children who ate were impulsive, were the least likely to finish school, the least likely to have a career, the least likely to remain married, the least likely to advance in their finances and own their own home. This is reality, right? The least likely to succeed in a material, physical sense, metric sense. The ones who were deceptive were the ones who would succeed and then lose it. They'd get married and be happy and have children and then lie and get divorced. They'd have a career and finish school and advance and blow it all. They were the ones who were most likely to have addictive behaviors. Tobacco and alcohol, zina. They were the ones who fell into problems. Although they had success in life, they gambled it away. The 15% were the ones who became industry leaders. The ones who were happily married. The ones whose children also resisted the marshmallow test. Sabr is something taught. Allah teaches us sabr. Al-Imam Ibn Al-Qayyim, rahimahullah, he said that patience is of three types. The most difficult thing to be patient, as-sabr ala al-ma'mur. To be patient in what Allah asked you to do. إِنَّهَا لَكَبِيرَةً صَلَاةً Wallahi, it's a big thing. Very difficult. إِلَّا عَلَى الْخَاشِعِينَ Except the one who's humble, who's silent in their heart with Allah. You will have a greater battle with your soul, with your mind, with your body to wake up for Fajr every day of your life than it will be for you to not take drugs, not to commit zina. That's easy. Not to drink alcohol or go to a bar or commit riba. It's more difficult for you to do your salah than it is to stay away from haram. Because it's kabir, it's a major thing. As-sabr ala ta'a, ala al-ma'mur. What you're ordered to do will be very difficult. Second, as-sabr ala al-mahdoor. To be patient in what Allah said, don't come near it. The Prophet ﷺ said, إِذَا أَمَرْتُكُمْ بِشَيْءٍ فَأْتُ بِهِ مَا اسْتَطَعْتُمْ Whenever I recommend something, do as much of it as you can. And that's why there's so many abwab fil khayr, so many gates of good, you can't do all of them, you do as much of them as you can. وَإِذَا نَهَيْتُكُمْ عَنْ شَيْءٍ فَانْتَهُوا But when I tell you stay away from something, don't go near it, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Third, الصبر على البلاء. The least thing that you have to worry about is sabr when Allah tests you. Although that's the one we put in our mind, it requires sabr, sabr, sabr. That's the least thing you have to worry about. It's not often that Allah sends you a tamma, a major calamity. في كل عام مرة أو مرتين, once or twice a year, تفتنون, you get a fitna. But every day, there's fajr. Every day, there's isha. It's difficult. So Allah gives you the month of Ramadan and adds in it extra salah. Subhanallah. Have you ever seen the Muslim who doesn't pray Fajr but comes to Tarawih? Wallah. Wallah in my community. Subhanallah, there'd be some brothers who are not regular in the masjid for Fajr. Not, yani maybe even some of their family complain, Shaykh Yahya, can you speak to him about Fajr? Subhanallah, the month of Ramadan comes, Saf al-Awwal. 20 rak'ah, 8 rak'ah, doesn't matter what you pray, he's there the whole night. Allahu Akbar. Ramadan, ya akhi, Ramadan. They wish for the khayr. You will see somebody who doesn't fast, who doesn't pray, fasts in the month of Ramadan. Long hours. Say, subhanallah, ya ufti. You don't wear hijab, maybe you don't pray. And the month of Ramadan, hungry and thirsty for Allah. Because it's meant to encourage you to change things within you. وَهَذَا يُحْمَدْ And that's a blessed thing. Don't ever make anyone feel awkward about increasing their ibadah in the month of Ramadan. Say, where were you, Akhi? Ya Abd Ramadan. You're only a worshiper in Ramadan. Ya Alhamdulillah. May Allah give them Sha'ban and Ramadan. May Allah give them Rajab and Sha'ban and Ramadan. May Allah increase them year after year. Where were you a few years ago? And therefore Ramadan comes to teach us to delay gratification, to be able to hold on for something greater. So Allah promises you the greatest thing for fasting, that there's a door in Jannah. لا يدخل منه إلا الصائم. No one enters from that door except the one who fasts to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allahu Akbar. May Allah allow us to enter from that gate. Allahumma ameen. My final words of advice, inshaAllah. حتى لا أطيل عليكم. So I don't take too much of your time. Is a manhaj of change, a methodology, things that you can do, building one on top of the other, to bring about change this Ramadan that maybe you did not experience in previous Ramadans. First of them is a niyyah, intention. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, وَهُوَ أَوَّلَ حَدِيثٍ فِي الصَّحِيحِ. The first hadith in Sahih al-Bukhari, عن أبا حفصٍ رضي الله عنه وأرضاه, from Amir al-Mu'mineen Umar ibn Khattab. And he's the only one who reports it from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم إنما الأعمال بالنيات. Actions are judged in accordance to their intentions. What does this mean? SubhanAllah. It means in everything in life, when you put a goal in your mind, you will achieve it. You want to be an engineer, Yafi? You want to be an engineer? You made that niyyah here? You can see it in your mind? You put it in here and you're going to give the amal? You're going to work? If you put a target in your mind, you want to be a millionaire? You put it in here and work towards it. This is what Allah is saying. إِنَّمَا الْأَعْمَالُ بِالنِّيَّةِ. You know, some of the unbelievers, they have this saying, they call it the secret. You listen to Oprah Winfrey and these people, she says, I found the secret to success. What is it? You wish in your mind and it will come. Meaning, يعني, نية. You put in your mind your target and work towards it. It sounds simple, but it's difficult. Anything you've ever made true, sincere niyyah for, you've accomplished in your life. Go back with yourself, sit with yourself tonight. And I want you to think about the things you were serious about in your mind, in your heart. You said, I'm going to do it. Anything you said, I'm going to do it. And then you gave it amal, you put it into practice, you attain it. It's the promise of Allah and His Nabi Muhammad ﷺ. So what's your niyyah for Ramadan? You smoke? Make a niyyah. What's your niyyah? What do you want? I say this to some of my students. I'm a principal. I'm a deputy principal at a high school. Are you here to be cool? That's what you get. You're the cool guy in school because that's your niyyah. You dress cool. You talk cool. You hang out cool. MashaAllah. No problem. Are you here to be an A student? That's your niyyah. You're going to do your homework. You're going to give attention in class. You're going to sit away from your friends. You're going to take some of your lunch and your recess to do extra work. You're going to follow up with your teacher. That's your niyyah. Wallahi, you're going to achieve it. What do you want? What do you want out of life? What's your aim? إِنَّمَا الْأَعْمَالُ بِالنِّيَّاتِ. In another riwayah, إِنَّمَا الْأَعْمَالُ بِالنِّيَّةِ. Not niyat plural, بِالنِّيَّةِ. One niyyah. What's the one thing you're going to focus on? And I want you now to sit with yourself. You know what Allah says to the mushrikeen? أَعِذُكُمْ بِوَاحِدَةً. Allah says, I give you advice in one thing. And تَقُولُ اللَّهِ مَثْنَا وَفُرَادًا. That when you're thinking, they were thinking, should we believe in Muhammad or not? مَثْنَا وَفُرَادًا. Sit by yourself. Or maybe with someone you trust. One other person. Don't sit in a group and talk. Talking is for fools. You have action. That's what you do. That's how you gain. مَثْنَا وَفُرَادًا. You and one other person or just on your own. ثُمَّ تَتَفَكَّرُوا. Then think. and make a decision. What do you want this Ramadan? What's your aim? What's going to be your success? What are you going to achieve? إِنَّمَا الْأَعْمَالُ بِالنِّيَّةِ. Your amal will only follow what your niyyah is. And any time you do a amal and stop, anytime you begin something and it ends, you don't complete it. Do you know what the problem was? Niyyah. You started school, didn't finish it. Why? Because you weren't interested. It's not your niyyah. It's not your niyyah. You didn't take it serious. It's not in your mind, not in your heart. There's no drive. That's what athletes talk about. They talk about, you know, you got spirit. He's got courage. He won't stop. He gets put down, he gets up. Niyyah. It's called heart. It's what keeps a boxer standing on his feet. It's not that his body can take more punches, but his heart can. Niyyah. Therefore the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he says in the hadith of Imam Muslim, that in your body there's a place. إِذَا صَلُحَ صَلُحَ الْعَمَلِ كُلُّ. If that place is pure, which is where your intention is, inside you. If it's saleem, everything else will be saleem. وَإِذَا فَسَدَ فَسَدَ. If it's not, everything else comes to ruin. May Allah give us firm hearts. Allahumma ameen. So make your niyyah this Ramadan. What do you want? Do you want to finish the whole Quran? From beginning to end? Do you want to make sure you pray every single rak'ah in Taraweeh with the Imam? Do you want to change something negative in your life that you're struggling with outside Ramadan and you hope that Allah will help you? وَسُلْسِلَةِ الشَّيَاطِينِ مَرَضَةَ الْجِنِ. That the devils are put away that you can focus? Is that your niyyah? Bismillah. This is the month. It's a month of barakah. Number two, understand that the month of Ramadan is shahrun mubarak. It's a month of blessing. Do you know what the word barakah means? Who can tell me what is barakah? Tafadhal habibi. Kathratul khayr. Ba'dal. It's excessive good that comes after hardship. SubhanAllah. Think of everything Allah said, it has barakah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us Makkah al-Mukarramah is a place of barakah. Yet when he says to Ibrahim, go to this valley in Bakkah, Ibrahim sees it and he says, fi ardin ghayri dhi zar'. There's no vegetation, no water. Inda baytika al-Muharram, near your sacred house, ya Allah. It's barren. Nobody here. فَاجْعَلْ أَفْئِدَةً مِّنَ النَّاسِ تَهْوِي إِلَيْهِ. Oh Allah, send somebody who have soft hearts to my wife and Ismail, my son. Where is the barakah? It's not in it coming on its own, it's in your struggle. Hajar alayhi salam, she stands on the mountain of Safa about to die. Day after day, her water has come to an end, her milk has dried up, her son is crying. She's making dua. The son of a prophet is thirsty. Ya Allah, Allahumma aghithna. Not enough. So she runs from one mountain to the other. Makes dua again. Nothing. Again. One, two, three, five, six, seven. Finally, Allah sends the angel. Barakah. Barakah means hardship that you're patient in to receive reward. Allah describes Bayt al-Maqdis, Jerusalem. الَّذِي بَارَكْنَا حَوْلَهَا. I put barakah all around it. Jerusalem is the most contested city in human history. Destroyed over and over and over. Destroyed by the Romans, destroyed by the Persians, destroyed, destroyed, destroyed. Where's the barakah? Uzair, Allah mentions it in Surah Al-Baqarah. أَوْ كَالَّذِي مَرَّ عَلَىٰ قَرْيَةٍ. He comes upon this city, this village that used to be a place of worship. He sees Jerusalem having been destroyed. وَهِيَ خَاوِيَةٌ عَلَىٰ عُرُوشِهَا قَالَ أَنَّا يَحْيَانَ. How can Allah bring this? Who will come to worship Allah here again? فَأَمَاتَهُ اللَّهُ مِئَةَ عَامٍ. Allah said, huh? 100 years. Allah puts him in minor death. ثُمَّ بَعْثَ. Wakes him up. قَالَ كَمْ لَبِثْتُ. قَالَ لَبِثْتُ مِئَةَ عَامٍ. 100 years. انظر الى حمارك, your horse, your donkey is dead. And I put it back, ننجزها, your bones come together. Go now and see the city. Baraka. After destruction, you rise. After hardship, after sin, after mistake, you become better. You change. In the month of Ramadan, after hunger, after thirst, after sadaqah, after giving, you become better. Barakah is ascribed to the month of Ramadan. Shahrun Mubarak. It's a month of difficulty to attain ease. Inna ma'al usr, yusr. There's no yusr without, because you won't know it's yusr unless you've experienced usr. Unless you've experienced hardship, you won't enjoy the ease. Unless you know difficulty, you will not understand facility. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us barakah. Allow us to endure the hardship with thabat, with faith in Allah. Was Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam al-Nabiyya al-Mubarak? Did anybody have more barakah than Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? Nobody. And that's why he had the most difficult life. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He buried 5 children. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Could you imagine? He buried grandchildren. He buried spouses, his wives, Khadija, Umm al-Mu'mineen, radiallahu anha wa ardaha. Uncles, who he loved, but would not come to faith. إِنَّكَ لَا تَهْدِي مَنْ أَحْبَبْتَ. Hamza, radiallahu anhu. He would see Ammar and his father and mother being tortured. And all he could say to them is, صَبْرًا آلَ يَاسَرْ. Be patient, O family of Yasir. The next time I see you is Jannah. SubhanAllah. إِنَّ مَوْعِدَكُمُ الْجَنَّةِ. Your promise with me, I will see you in Jannah. I can't do anything. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This man, Mubarak. His hair, barakah. His spit, barakah. His touch, barakah. His dua, barakah. Yet, tested by Allah, he would say to the Sahaba, أَشَدُّ النَّاسِ بَلَاءً الْأَنْبِيَاءَ. The most tested by Allah are the prophets of Allah. يُبْتَلَ الرَّجُلُ عَلَى حَسَبْ دِينِ. A man is tested on account of their iman. ثُمَّ الْأَمْثَلُ فَالْأَمْثَلُ. The closest you are in conduct to the prophets, the bigger your test. So understand barakah. Understand that when you ask Allah for khayr in the month of Ramadan, you might not be given khayr straight away unless you have to struggle. And a struggle is a good thing. It means Allah is helping you, protecting you, saving you from al-bala al-azim. There's two ways Allah tests us. Regularly, small ways. Every day, every week, something, subhanAllah, comes up. Yani, right and left, every day, or something difficult. And he said, Alhamdulillah, قدر الله ما شاء فعل. حسبي الله ونعم الوكيل. Allah is sufficient for you. Or, may Allah protect us. Everything is happy. Nothing bad. If you're sitting with me right now, and nothing bad, be worried. The Prophet ﷺ said, المؤمن له صداع. A believer has a headache. صلى الله عليه وسلم في الحديث في الصحيح. A believer always has a headache, always I'm worried on their mind. If you're sitting here in mashallah, La ilaha illallah, may Allah protect you. Prophet ﷺ said, كما روى الإمام البخاري, إذا رأيت الله يعطي العبد ما يحب. For Allah, if you see Allah giving somebody everything they love, everything يحب, everything they love, وهو مقيم على معصية, that man, that woman, you see them also sinning. Every time they want something from Allah, there. Job, family, happy, money, health. SubhanAllah. And that man doesn't pray. وَأَنْتَ. You pray and fajr and tahajjud and witr and sunnah. And SubhanAllah, ya akhi, Shaykh, I've been looking for a job for 8 months, 1 year, 2 years. Shaykh, SubhanAllah, my father's unwell. My mother is this. My rent is due. My up. SubhanAllah. This guy, لا صلاة ولا شيء. Everything given to him. Prophet ﷺ says, when you see somebody like that, they have ma'asiyah, and everything they want is given to them. فَعْلَمْ Know in your heart أَنَّهُ اسْتِدْرَاجٌ لَهُمْ مِنَ اللَّهِ That Allah is bringing them, giving them time before Allah wipes them out. فَإِذَا أَخَذَهُ لَمْ يُفْلِتْ When Allah will take them, He will not let them go. Allah says in Surah Al-An'am, فَلَمَّا نَسُوا مَا ذُكِّرُوا بِهِ When they forgot what they were ordered to remember, when the dhikr was forgotten, فَتَحْنَا عَلَيْهِمْ أَبْوَابَ كُلِّ شَيْءٍ I opened to them the gates of all happiness. SubhanAllah. They forgot the Quran, forgot the Torah, forgot the Injil, forgot the Sunnah. They forgot what's good. Allah gives them what they want? Yes. That's the Sunnah of Allah. When they forgot everything, I gave them happiness. Hatta idha farihu. Until they became delighted. Akhadnahum baghta. I took them suddenly. فَإِذَا هُمْ مُبْلِسُونَ Then they regret. May Allah protect us, Ya Allah. Niyya is the beginning. Understanding that difficulty is barakah. It's a blessing. And the month of Ramadan is a month where you want to put your body to test. Fast and pray. Be hungry. And thirsty, be tired. Have black eyes under black marks under your eye. You only slept 4 hours because you did your qiyam and you recited your Quran and you're like as Allah has wanted. The Prophet ﷺ said, "الصيام والقرآن يشفعان للعبد كما روى الإمام مسلم." Siyam and Quran will ask Allah to protect you on the day of judgment. يقول الصيام رَبِّ إِنِّي مَنَعْتُهُمْ الطَّعَامَ وَالشَّرَابَ وَالشَّهْوَةَ بِالنَّهَارِ Siyam will say, Oh Allah, I kept him from eating and drinking and his lust in the day. اللهم شفعني فيه Oh Allah, let me speak on his behalf. ويقول القرآن The Quran will say, اللهم إِنِّي مَنَعْتُهُ النَّوْمَ بِالْلَيْلِ Oh Allah, I kept him awake at night. The Quran, قُرْآنًا فَرَقْنَاهُ لِتَقْرَأَهُ عَلَى مُكْرِ It was meant to be recited in melody in the evening hours. يَا أَيُّهَا الْمُزَّمِّلْ قُمِ اللَّيْلِ تَتَجَافَ جُنُوبُهُمْ عَنِ الْمَضَاجِعِ Allah says that your back, your shoulder, has jafa, has hate for your bed. Has hate. Jafa means if you walk into a room and you see someone, you say disgusted by you. You walk out. That's what a believer has when they see their bed at night. Al-Imam al-Shafi'i, I'll give you an example. Imam al-Shafi'i used to make dua against his bed. He would look at his bed and he would say, قاتلك الله. May Allah destroy you. ما أنعمك. You're so soft. SubhanAllah. You keep asking me to come and sleep. Imam al-Shafi'i, قاتلك الله. I hate you. That comfortable bed. جفاء. فلا تعلم نفسي. In the month of Ramadan, there's Qiyam, and there's Taraweeh, and there's Salah, and there's... Go with the Khayr. You will find the Barakah. Third and finally, bi-idhnillahi ta'ala, is to make peace with those who wronged us, or we have wronged them. And I begin with those who wronged you. And you say, Brother Yahya, if they wronged me, why do I make peace with them? They should make... Peace with me. Nah. You don't understand the deen of Allah Azza wa Jalla if this is your mind. You need to find love in Ramadan. I've written 2 articles called Finding Love in Ramadan, Part 1 and 2. Google it inshallah. Read it on your own time. In the month of Ramadan, one of your greatest aim is to fix what others have broken with you. You're going to say to me, Sheikh Yahya, Akhi Yahya, this guy, this girl, this lady, Wallahi they're wrong. Wallahi they said about me. Wallahi they did to me. Wallahi they took from me. And I say, I agree. Mash. And? Khalas, what do you want me to do? Don't let them do it to you again, but forgive them. وكل الأمر لله. Leave it to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But if that person who took from you, who wronged you, who borrowed money, didn't return it, asks you to come to his daughter's wedding, go. They get sick, visit. It's Ramadan and they invite you for food, eat it and go. حق المسلم على المسلم. سبحان الله. You see them, ابدأ بالسلام. Say assalamu alaikum before they say it. Wallahi ya akhi, if I say it, if he saw me, he wouldn't say it to me. I didn't ask if he would say it to you. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, the one who's better is the one who begins. But he owes me money. I know he owes you money. What does that have to do with salam? Wa anna al-masajid lillah. You came to the masjid. That man stands with you in Taraweeh. He faces a qibla. He eats halal. He's a Muslim. لَهُ بَرَاءَةُ الذِّمَّةِ. He owes you money? Ask him for it. Ask somebody to intervene. Give him time. Forgive him. But don't put in your heart, رَبَّنَا لَا تَجْعَلْ فِي قُلُوبِنَا غِلًّا لِلَّذِينَ آمَنُوا. Oh Allah, don't put in our heart anger, rancor, wrath against those who believe. La ilaha illallah. It's difficult. Wallahi, it's difficult. It's difficult in your heart to free it from hate towards someone who you should hate. Yani someone, there's no reason for you to love them. They wronged you. One of the most beautiful hadith in al-Bukhari. And there's a chapter for it. The Prophet ﷺ said, Allahumma salli ala nabiyyina Muhammad. That Allah said, wajabat mahabbati. My love, the love of Allah is wajib. Is definite. For who? To those who love others for me. You know when you say, أحبك الله الذي أحببتني. I love you for Allah's sake. What does this mean? I remember my teacher, he said to me, يا حين تفهمت إن الحديث. What do you understand? I said, يعني لو بنحب ببعض ربنا يغفر لنا. If we love each other, Allah. He goes, لا, it's more than this. It's that you love the unlovable. SubhanAllah. I love my mother. Of course, she's your mother. I love my father, I love my children, love my wife, love my friends, love my family. Easy. You want Allah's love? It's not to love them. That's natural. You have to find love in your heart only for Allah's sake. If it wasn't for Allah, I would hate you. If it wasn't for Allah, I wouldn't look in your face. If it wasn't for Allah, I would never stand next to you. But it's for Allah. That person, wajabat mahabbati. Allah gives you his love. Allahumma inna nas'aluka hubbak. The dua of the Prophet ﷺ. Oh Allah, we ask you for your love. وَحُبَّ مَنْ يُحِبُّكَ. And the love of those who love you. وَحُبَّ الْعَمَلِ الَّذِي يُقَرِّبُنَا إِلَى حُبِّكَ. And the love of doing what will bring your love. What is this doing? Is that you love others who are unlovable. Difficult to love them. Who took from you, who wronged you, who misspoke about you. The month of Ramadan is the month you're going to say, Allahumma ghfir li, oh Allah, forgive me. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, irhamu man fil ard, yarhamkum man fil sama. If you show compassion and forgiveness to those who live with you on earth, the one above the heavens will show you compassion. Meaning, oh Allah, forgive me. You can't turn then and say, Wallahi, akhi, I'll never forgive you. You're laylat al-qal. Allahumma ghfir lana, ameen. Wallahi, akhi, I'll never forgive you. Subhanallah. كيف يستجاب دعاءك? How can your dua be answered? How? Know in the month of Ramadan that your dua is subjective to what you're willing to give to others. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala open our hearts to asking Him to give guidance to those who wronged us. Could you imagine if the Prophet ﷺ couldn't love Umar radiallahu anhu, Khalid ibn al-Walid radiallahu anhu, Amr ibn al-As radiallahu anhu majma'in? Could you imagine? if because of their past or their actions, the Prophet ﷺ couldn't fasfah al-safha al-jameel, open a new beginning, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this blessed month of Ramadan fix what we have broken and connect hearts that have been separated. Akhi, if there's someone in your home, in your family that you're not speaking with, before the month of Ramadan, give them a call. Wallahi, I had two brothers, blood brothers, who hadn't spoken with each other in years. And I'm sitting with this. I said, call your brother. He goes, La ana al-akbar. I'm the older one. Huwa li kallimni. He has to call me. Aib. Ultimo ma fish aib. There's no aib. You're in front of me now. Call your brother. He goes, Wallahi, I deleted his number. He doesn't even have his brother's number in his phone. I said, Subhanallah, khud ya. Here's his number. Ya, I can leave off in bed when I go home. I said, Uddami, right now. If he sees my number, he won't answer. I said, I'm not asking you if he will answer or not. I'm asking you, call. Dias. First ring. Salaamu alaikum. He looks at me and goes, Awudu wa Allah ya akhi wa alaikum as-salam. Tell him wa alaikum as-salam. He goes, wa alaikum as-salam. His brother starts crying. Inta wahashtini. I miss you. So he starts crying. Wallahi inta wahashtini. If you were to ask them, why did the fight start? They can't remember. Wallah. Ultimo, tab winta ee li ba'adkum? What separate? I can't remember exactly what he said, exactly what he did, but he must have done something. In this blessed month of Ramadan, open your heart, even to those who you don't feel deserve it. They may not deserve it, but Allah demands it. They don't deserve it, but Allah asks you, أَلَا تُحِبُّونَ أَن يَغْفِرَ اللَّهُ لَكُمْ. This is what Allah says. Don't you want Allah to forgive you? Forgive. Don't you want Allah to forgive you? Subhanallah. Allahumma ighfir lana warhamna wa'afina wa'fu 'anna. Allahumma ihdina ila rushdina ya rabbal alamin. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to open our hearts, to lead us to that which is pleasing to Him, to make us from those who are fortunate in this dunya and akhirah, and to make us from those who have a Ramadan that is accepted. Allahumma balighna Ramadan. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to allow us to reach the month of Ramadan. Allahumma taqabbal minna Ramadan, our previous Ramadan. May Allah accept it from us. Allahumma ameen. Wa fi hadha al-kifaya wa salli Allahumma wa sallim. Wa zid wa barik ala sayyidina wa nabiyyina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Wa salamu alaykum wa rahmatullah. Before I turn you over, and the brothers from Muslim Aid, they asked me to offer you happiness. So you have two options, inshallah, all right? I'm gonna take, inshallah, and I say this for no other reason than to inspire you. Today, I'm going to commit to £60 for the month to feed a family, subhanallah. A whole family for the whole month of Ramadan. You have an opportunity that your siyam is not one siyam, but it could be the siyam of 5, 6, 7 people. Everyone you feed, you get there. مَنْ ثَبْطَرَ صَائِمًا. The Prophet ﷺ said, the one who gives iftar to one who is fasting, كَانَ لَهُ مِثْلُ أَجْرِ الصَّائِمِ غَيْرَ أَنَّ أَجْرَ الصَّائِمِ لَا يَنْقُصُ شَيْئًا. The one who gives food to somebody fasting, they receive the reward of the one who is fasting, even though the reward of the one who is fasting will not diminish. And perhaps the one who is fasting in need, in poverty, in hardship, maybe their fasting is accepted and yours is deficient. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allow all of us to make a commitment of £60. £2 a day. Wallahi, I bought a cup of... Your coffee is very expensive in London. SubhanAllah, £4.50? What is this? Do you know how much that is in Australia? That's $9. I get a coffee for $3.20. That's like 3 cups of coffee in Australia. London is not cheap, subhanAllah. For a cup of coffee, you can earn Jannah. SubhanAllah. You can save yourself with half a date. اتقوا النار ولو بشق تمرة. Half a date. Aisha radiallahu anha, the hadith is in al-Bukhari, in Sahih Muslim. A woman knocked on the door. And she had two young daughters. And she came to the house of the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, asking for food. She has nothing for herself and her daughter. Aisha, in the time of poverty, before Khaybar, she turns to her and she says, La najid, we don't have anything except these three dates. She only had three tamr in the house of Nabiyyina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. فَأَعْطَتْهُمْ إِيَّهُ. She gave it to the woman. When she gave it to the woman, she gave one to this daughter, one to this daughter, and she's going to eat the third. By the time she gave this one, this. And they looked up at the one in her hand. فَقَسَمَتْهَا بَيْنَهُمْ. She broke the date in half. She kept hungry. Mother, she stayed hungry and she gave it to them. فَعَجِبَتْ مِنْهَا عَائِشَ. Aisha was surprised, astonished. فَلَمَّا عَادَ النَّبِيُّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ أَخْبَرَتْ. When the Prophet returned, she told him, Ya Rasulullah, this woman did this. فَقَالَ لَهَا الْجَنَّةِ. She fed her own daughter? Her own daughter? The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said, Jannah is hers. صلى الله عليه وسلم. May Allah give us Jannah through the service and feeding of others. أَطْعِمُ الطَّعَامِ. Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said, feed people. تَدْخُلُ الْجَنَّةِ بِسَلَامِ. You will enter Jannah in peace. اللهم اجعلنا منهم يا رب. The second option is that you do £1 a day, which is £30 for the month of Ramadan. Whichever of the two you seek, I prefer for you £60 inshaAllah. وَيُضَاعِفُ اللَّهُ لِمَنْ يَشَاءُ. May Allah give us the reward many more times. اللهم آمين. May Allah use your wealth for more than you and your family. May Allah use your wealth for those who you've never met. SubhanAllah, the Prophet ﷺ said, As-sadaqa burhan. Charity is evidence. On the Day of Judgment, you'll see darkness all around you, and then there's light far away. You'll see light. And you say, whose light? That's my light. I see my light. This is me. This is my evidence. Oh Allah, bring it to me. And someone will come. It's your sadaqah. It's your sadaqah. Evidence for you on the Day of Judgment that what Allah gave you, you didn't keep to yourself. You shared it with others. May Allah increase you in good. Do your part, inshaAllah, for those who are near and far. Wa salli lahumma wa sallim wa zid wa barik ala Sayyidina wa Nabiyyina Muhammad. Aqulu qawli hadha wa astaghfirullah li wa lakum. Subhanakallahumma wa bihamdika ashhadu an la ilaha illa anta astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk. Hana waqtu as-salah. If you need to make your work.